Zhou Dynasty. The Zhou Dynasty or the Zhou Kingdom was a Chinese dynasty that followed the Shang Dynasty and preceded the Qin Dynasty. The Zhou Dynasty lasted longer than any other dynasty in Chinese history. The military control of China by the royal house, surnamed Ji, lasted initially from 1046 until 771 BC for a period known as the Western Zhou. In the political sphere of influence it created continued well into Eastern Zhou for another 500 years. During the Zhou Dynasty, centralized power decreased throughout the Spring and Autumn period until the Warring States period in the last two centuries of Zhou Dynasty. In this period, the Zhou court had little control over its constituent states that were at war with each other until the Qin state consolidated power and formed the Qin Dynasty in 221 BC. The Zhou Dynasty had formally collapsed only 35 years earlier, although the dynasty had only nominal power at that point. This period of Chinese history produced what many consider the zenith of Chinese bronzeware making. The Zhou Dynasty also spans the period in which the written script evolved into its almost modern form with the use of an archaic clerical script that emerged during the late Warring States period. According to Chinese mythology, the Zhou lineage began when Zhang Yuan, a consort of the legendary Emperor Ku, miraculously conceived a child, Qi the Abandoned One, after stepping into the divine footprint of Shangdi. Qi was a culture hero credited with surviving three abandonments by his mother on with greatly improving Xia agriculture, to the point where he was granted lordship over Tai in the surname Ji by his own Xia king and a later posthumous name, Hu Ji Lord of Millet, by the Tang of Shang. He even received sacrifice as a harvest god. The term Hu Ji was probably a hereditary title attached to a lineage. Qi's son, or rather that of the Hu Ji, Bu Zhu is said to have abandoned his position as agrarian master. Zhu's son Liu, however, led his people to prosperity by restoring agriculture and settling them at a place called Bin, which his descendants ruled for generations. Tai later led the clan from Bin to Zhou, an area in the Wei River Valley of modern-day Jishan County. The duke passed over his two elder sons Taibo and Deng Yuan to favor Jili, a warrior who conquered several Zhuang tribes as a vassal of the Shang kings Wu Yi and Wending before being treacherously killed. Taibo and Deng Yuan had supposedly already fled to the Yangtze Delta, where they established the state of Wu among the tribes there. Jili's son Wen bribed his way out of imprisonment and moved the Zhou capital to Fing. Around 1046 BC, Wen's son Wu and his ally Zhang Ziyi led an army of 45,000 men and 300 chariots across the Yellow River and defeated King Zhou of Shang at the Battle of Muyi, marking the beginning of the Zhou dynasty. The Zhou enfoffed a member of the defeated Shang royal family as the Duke of Song, which was held by descendants of the Shang royal family until its end. This practice was referred to as two kings, three reverences. According to Nicholas Bodman, the Zhou appear to have spoken a language not basically different in vocabulary and syntax from that of the Shang. A recent study by David McCraw, using lexical statistics, reached the same conclusion. The Zhou emulated extensively Shang cultural practices, perhaps to legitimize their own rule, and became the successors to Shang culture. At the same time, the Zhou may also have been connected to the Zhuang, a broadly defined cultural group to the west of the Shang, which the Shang regarded as tributaries. According to the historian Li Feng, the term Rong during the Western Zhou period was likely used to designate political and military adversaries rather than cultural and ethnic others. King Wu maintained the old capital for ceremonial purposes but constructed a new one for his palace and administration nearby at Hao. Although Wu's early death left a young and inexperienced heir, the Duke of Zhou assisted his nephew King Cheng in consolidating royal power. Wary of the Duke of Zhou's increasing power, the three guards, Zhou princes stationed on the eastern plain, rose in rebellion against his regency. Even though they garnered the support of independent-minded nobles, Shang partisans and several Dongyi tribes, the Duke of Zhou quelled the rebellion, and further expanded the Zhou kingdom into the east. To maintain Zhou authority over its greatly expanded territory and prevent other revolts, he set up the Fengjian system. Furthermore, he countered Zhou's crisis of legitimacy by expounding the doctrine of the Mandate of Heaven while accommodating important Shang rituals at Wangcheng and Changzhou. Over time, this decentralized system became strained as the familial relationships between the Zhou kings and the regional dynasties thinned over the generations. Peripheral territories developed local power and prestige on par with that of the Zhou. When King Yu demoted and exiled his Jiang queen in favor of the beautiful commoner Bao Si, The disgraced queen's father, the Marquis of Shen, joined with Zheng and the Quanrong barbarians to sack Hou in 771 BC. Some modern scholars have surmised that the sack of Hojing might have been connected to a Scythian raid from the Altai before their westward expansion. With King Yu dead, a conclave of nobles met at Shen and declared the Marquis's grandson King Ping. The capital was moved eastward to Wangcheng, marking the end of the Western Zhou and the beginning of the Eastern Zhou dynasty. The Eastern Zhou was characterized by an accelerating collapse of royal authority, although the king's ritual importance allowed over five more centuries of rule. The Confucian chronicle of the early years of this process led to its title of the Spring and Autumn Period. The partition of Jin in the mid-5th century BC initiated a second phase, the Warring States. In 403 BC, the Zhou court recognized Han, Zhou, and Wei as fully independent states. Duke Wei of Wei, in 344 BC, was the first to claim the royal title of king for himself. Others followed, marking a turning point, as rulers did not even entertain the pretense of being vassals of the Zhou court, instead proclaiming themselves fully independent kingdoms. A series of states rose to prominence before each falling in turn, and Zhou was a minor player in most of these conflicts. The last Zhou king is traditionally taken to be Nan, who was killed when Qin captured the capital Wangcheng in 256 BC. A king Hewei was declared, but his splinter state was fully removed by 249 BC. Qin's unification of China concluded in 221 BC with Qin Shi Huang's annexation of Qi. The Eastern Zhou, however, is also remembered as the Golden Age of Chinese philosophy, the hundred schools of thought which flourished as rival lords patronized the itinerant Qi scholars as led by the example of Qi's Jixi Academy. The nine schools of thought which came to dominate the others were Confucianism, Legalism, Taoism, Mohism, the utopian communalist agriculturalism, two strains of diplomatists, the sophistic logicians, Sun Tzu's militarists, and the naturalists. Although only the first three of these went on to receive imperial patronage in later dynasties, doctrines from each influenced the others in Chinese society in sometimes unusual ways. The Mohists, for instance, found little interest in their praise of meritocracy but much acceptance for their mastery of defensive siege warfare. Much later, however, their arguments against nepotism were used in favor of establishing the imperial examination system. Zhou rulers introduced what was to prove one of East Asia's most enduring political doctrines, the concept of the Mandate of Heaven. They did this so by asserting that their moral superiority justified taking over Shang wealth and territories, also that heaven had imposed a moral mandate on them to replace the Shang and return good governance to the people. The Mandate of Heaven was presented as a religious compact between the Zhou people and their supreme god in heaven. The Zhou agreed that since worldly affairs were supposed to align with those of the heavens conferred legitimate power on only one person, the Zhou ruler. In return, the ruler was duty-bound to uphold heaven's principles of harmony and honor. Any ruler who failed in this duty, who let instability creep into earthly affairs, or who let his people suffer, would lose the mandate. Under this system, it was the prerogative of spiritual authority to withdraw support from any wayward ruler and to find another, more worthy one. In this way, the Zhou sky god legitimated regime change. In using this creed, the Zhou rulers had to acknowledge that any group of rulers, even they themselves, could be ousted if they lost the mandate of heaven because of improper practices. The Book of Odes written during the Zhou period clearly intoned this caution. The early Zhou kings contended that heaven favored their triumph because the last Shang kings had been evil men whose policies brought pain to the people through waste and corruption. After the Zhou came to power, the mandate became a political tool. One of the duties and privileges of the king was to create a royal calendar. This official document defined times for undertaking agricultural activities and celebrating rituals. But unexpected events such as solar eclipses or natural calamities threw the ruling house's mandate into question. Since rulers claimed that their authority came from heaven, the Zhou made great efforts to gain accurate knowledge of the stars and to perfect the astronomical system on which they based their calendar. Zhou legitimacy also arose indirectly from Shang material culture through the use of bronze ritual vessels, statues, ornaments, and weapons. As the Zhou emulated the Shang's large-scale production of ceremonial bronzes, they developed an extensive system of bronze metalworking that required a large force of tribute labor. Many of its members were Shang, who were sometimes forcibly transported to New Zhou to produce the bronze ritual objects which were then sold and distributed across the lands, symbolizing Zhou legitimacy. Western writers often describe the Zhou period as feudal because the Zhou's Fengjian system invites comparison with medieval rule in Europe. There were many similarities between the decentralized systems. When the dynasty was established, the conquered land was divided into hereditary fiefs that eventually became powerful in their own right. In matters of inheritance, the Zhou dynasty recognized only patrilineal primogeniture as legal. According to Cao, the Chunfa or descent line system has the following characteristics: patrilineal descent, patrilineal succession, patriarchate, subexogamy, and primogeniture. The system, also called extensive stratified patrilineage, was defined by the anthropologist Quang Qichang as characterized by the fact that the eldest son of each generation formed the main of line descent and political authority, whereas the younger brothers were moved out to establish new lineages off lesser authority. The farther removed, the lesser the political authority. Every defines the descent line system as follows: a great line is the line of eldest sons continuing indefinitely from a founding ancestor. A lesser line is the line of younger sons going back no more than five generations. Great lines and lesser lines continually spin off new lesser lines, founded by younger sons. K.E. Brashear writes in his book Ancestral Memory in Early China about the Chunfa system of patrilineal primogeniture. The greater lineage, if it has survived, is the direct succession from father to eldest son and is not defined via the collateral shifts of the lesser lineages. In discussions that demarcate between trunk and collateral lines, the former is called a Zong and the latter a Tzu, whereas the whole lineage is dubbed the Shi. On one hand, every son who is not the eldest and hence not heir to the lineage territory has the potential of becoming a progenitor and fostering a new trunk lineage. According to the Zhou commentary, the Son of Heaven divided land among his feudal lords, his feudal lords divided land among their dependent families and so forth down the pecking order to the officers who had their dependent kin and the commoners who each had his apportioned relations and all had their graded precedence. This type of unilineal descent group later became the model of the Korean family through the influence of Neo-Confucianism, as Zhu Zai and others advocated its re-establishment in China. There were five peerage ranks below the royal ranks, in descending order with common English translations: Gong Duke, Ho Marquis, Bo Count, Zi Viscount, and Nan Baron. At times, a vigorous duke would take power from his nobles and centralize the state. Centralization became more necessary as the states began to war among themselves and decentralization encouraged more war. If a duke took power from his nobles, the state would have to be administered bureaucratically by appointed officials. Despite these similarities, there are a number of important differences from medieval Europe. One obvious difference is that the Zhou ruled from walled cities rather than castles. Another was China's distinct class system, which lacked an organized clergy but saw the Shangxi clan yeomen become masters of ritual and ceremony known as Shi. When a dukedom was centralized, these people would find employment as government officials or officers. These hereditary classes were similar to Western knights in status and breeding, but like Western clergy were expected to be something of a scholar instead of a warrior. Being appointed, they could move from one state to another. Some would travel from state to state peddling schemes of administrative or military reform. Those who could not find employment would often end up teaching young men who aspired to official status. The most famous of these was Confucius, who taught a system of mutual duty between superiors and inferiors. In contrast, the legalists had no time for Confucian virtue and advocated a system of strict laws and harsh punishments. The wars of the warring states were finally ended by the most legalist state of all, Qin. When the Qin dynasty fell and was replaced by the Han dynasty, many Chinese were relieved to return to the more humane virtues of Confucius. Agriculture in the Zhou dynasty was very intensive and, in many cases, directed by the government. All farming lands were owned by nobles, who then gave their land to their serfs, a situation similar to European feudalism. For example, a piece of land was divided into nine squares in the wellfield system, with the grain from the middle square taken by the government and that of surrounding squares kept by individual farmers. This way, the government was able to store surplus food and distribute it in times of famine or bad harvest. Some important manufacturing sectors during these period included bronze smelting, which was integral to making weapons and farming tools. Again, these industries were dominated by the nobility who directed the production of such materials. China's first projects of hydraulic engineering were initiated during the Zhou dynasty, ultimately as a means to aid agricultural irrigation. The Chancellor of Wei, Sun Xiuao, who served King Zhuang of Chu, dammed a river to create an enormous irrigation reservoir in modern-day northern Anhui province. For this, Sun Xiu is credited as China's first hydraulic engineer. The later Wei statesman Qi Munbao, who served Marquis Wen of Wei, was the first hydraulic engineer of China to have created a large irrigation canal system. As the main focus of his grandiose project, his canal work eventually diverted the waters of the entire Jiang River to a spot further up the Yellow River. The early Western Zhou supported a strong army, split into two major units, the Six Armies of the West and the Eight Armies of Changzhou. The armies campaigned in the northern Loess Plateau, modern Ningxia, and the Yellow River floodplain. The military prowess of Zhou peaked during the 19th year of King Zhao's reign, when the Six Armies were wiped out along with King Zhao on a campaign around the Han River. Early Zhou kings were true commanders-in-chief. They were in constant wars with barbarians on behalf of the fiefs called Guo, which at that time meant statelet or principality. King Zhao was famous for repeated campaigns in the Yangtze areas and died in his last action. Later kings' campaigns were less effective. King Li led 14 armies against barbarians in the south, but failed to achieve any victory. King Xuan fought the Quanrong nomads in vain. King Yu was killed by the Quanrong when Hojing was sacked. Although chariots had been introduced to China during the Shang dynasty from Central Asia, the Zhou period saw the first major use of chariots in battle. Recent archaeological finds demonstrate similarities between horse burials of the Shang and Zhou dynasties and Indo-European peoples in the West. Other possible cultural influences resulting from Indo-European contact in this period may include fighting styles, head and hooves burials, art motifs and myths. During the Zhou dynasty, the origins of native Chinese philosophy developed, its initial stages beginning in the 6th century BC. The greatest Chinese philosophers, those who made the greatest impact on later generations of Chinese, were Confucius, founder of Confucianism, and Lao Tzu, founder of Taoism. Other philosophers, theorists, and schools of thought in this era were Mozi, founder of Mohism, Mencius, a famous Confucian who expanded upon Confucius' legacy, Shangyang and Han Fei, responsible for the development of ancient Chinese legalism, and Xunzi, who was arguably the center of ancient Chinese intellectual life during his time, even more so than iconic intellectual figures such as Mencius. Established during the Western period, the Li ritual system encoded an understanding of manners as an expression of the social hierarchy, ethics, and regulation concerning material life. The corresponding social practices became idealized within Confucian ideology. The system was canonized in the Book of Rites, Zhouli, and Yili compendiums of the Han dynasty, thus becoming the heart of the Chinese imperial ideology. While the system was initially a respected body of concrete regulations, the fragmentation of the Western Zhou period led the ritual to drift towards moralization and formalization in regard to. The rulers of the Zhou dynasty were titled Wang, which is normally translated into English as king and was also the Shang term for their rulers. In addition to these rulers, King Wu's immediate ancestors Danfu, Jili, and Wen are also referred to as kings of Zhou, despite having been nominal vassals of the Shang kings. N.B. Dates in Chinese history before the first year of the Gong Regency in 841 BC are contentious and varied by source. Those below are those published by Xia Shang Zhou Chronology Project and Edward L. Shaughnessy's The Absolute Chronology of the Western Zhou Dynasty. Nobles of the Ji family proclaimed Duke Wei of Eastern Zhou as King Nan's successor after their capital, Changzhou, fell to Qin forces in 256 BC. Ji Zhou, a son of King Nan, led a resistance against Qin for 5 years. The dukedom fell in 249 BC. The remaining Ji family ruled Yan and Wei until 209 BC. The Han dynasty bestowed the hereditary title upon the Zhou dynasty royal descendant Ji Jia and his descendants. This practice was referred to as. According to the New Book of Tang, the Sui dynasty emperors were patrilineally descended from the Zhou dynasty kings via Ji Bokao, who was the son of Duke Wu of Jin. Ji Bokao's family became known as the Sheep Tongue family. The Yang of Hungnong were asserted as ancestors by the Sui emperors, like the Longxi Lis were asserted as ancestors of the Tang emperors. The Li of Zhaojun and the Lu of Fanyang hailed from Shandong and were related to the Liu clan, which was also linked to the Yang of Hungnong and other clans of Guanlong. Duke Wu of Jin was claimed as the ancestors of the Hungnong Yang. The Yang of Hungnong, Ji of Hedong, Xiong of Henai, and Wang of Taoyuan from the Tang dynasty were claimed as ancestors by Song dynasty lineages. There were dukedoms for the offspring of the royal familias of the Zhou dynasty, Sui dynasty, and Tang dynasty in the later Jin. The Zhou dynasty King Ling's son Prince Jin is assumed by most to be the ancestor of the Taiyuan Wang lineage. The Longmen Wang were a cadet line of the Zhou dynasty descended Taiyuan Wang, and Wang Yan and his grandson Wang Tong hailed from his cadet line. Both Buddhist monks and scholars hailed from the Wang family of Taoyuan, such as the monk Tangyan. The Wang family of Taoyuan included Wang Huan. The Taoyuan Wang family produced Wang Jun, who served under Emperor Wai of Jin. A Fuzhou-based section of the Taoyuan Wang produced the Buddhist monk Bai Zhang. During the Tang dynasty, the Li family of Zhao Jun, the Kui family of Boling, the Kui family of Qing, the Lu family of Fan Yang, the Zheng family of Xing Yong, the Wang family of Taoyuan, and the Li family of Longxi were the seven noble families between whom marriage was banned by law. Moriyama Tsuo wrote a history of the later Han Tang period of the Taoyuan Wang. Among the strongest families was the Taoyuan Wang. The prohibition on marriage between the clans issued in 659 by the Jizong Emperor was flouted by the seven families, since a woman of the Boling Kui married a member of the Taoyuan Wang, giving birth to the poet Wang Wei. He was the son of Wang Chulian, who in turn was the son of Wang Zhou. The marriages between the families were performed clandestinely after the prohibition was implemented on the seven families by Jizong. Their status as seven great surnames became known during Jizong's rule. The Zhou dynasty kings are the ancestors of the Zhou clan of Runan. The Linghu of Dunhuang were descended from King Wen of Zhou through his son Duke Gao of Bai. The Zheng family of Xingyang claimed descent from the Zhou dynasty kings via the rulers of the state of Zheng. The Marquis of Xingyang rank was created for Zheng Zai. The Xingyang Zheng spawned Zheng Dashao and Zheng Zai. Zheng Wanjin was a member of the Xingyang Zheng. The Xingyang Zheng spawned Zheng Yuzhong. The Xingyang Zheng spawned Zheng Jiang. The Zheng of Xingyang may have been miswritten in the records as the Zheng of Xingyang. Family tree of the descendants of the Duke of Zhou in Chinese. The main line of the Duke of Zhou's descendants came from his firstborn son, the State of Lu ruler Bo Qin's third son Yu, whose descendants adopted the surname Dongyi. The Duke of Zhou's offspring held the title of Wu Jing Boshi. Duke Huan of Lu's son through Quang Fu was the ancestor of Mencius. He was descended from Duke Yang of the State of Lu. Duke Yang was the son of Bo Qin, who was the son of the Duke of Zhou. The genealogy is found in the Mencius family tree. Mencius's descendants were awarded the Wu Jing Boshi title. One of the Duke of Zhou's 72-generation descendants' family tree was examined and commented on by Song Lian. Zhou is represented by two stars, 8 a Capricorni and 21 Capricorni, in 12 states asterism. Zhou is also represented by the star Beta Serpentis in asterism right wall, heavenly market enclosure. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.